applicator that Paul used to apply to the problem of his covetousness. He found his coveting sin sore erupting like Mount Vesuvius. Notice his desperate but honest cry in verse 24 as he recognizes the inability of the law to resolve the sin nature problem that was a reality in his fleshly makeup, and for that matter, ours. Listen to our apostle in Romans 7:24. Oh, wretched man that I used to be. Oh, wretched man that I am. Who shall deliver me from the body of this death? Who's going to fix Paul from this fight that was going on within Paul, the battle between the spirit and the flesh, the battle between the spiritual position and the fleshly condition? You know what the ever-presence of the sinful nature was like to our apostle, who could not escape it? He called it the body of this death. How many of us can actually picture ourselves in that same dilemma? Thoughts. Now, Paul goes to the 10th commandment, a thought commandment. Never an evil thought. No coveting. No lust of any type. No inordinate desire of any way, in any way. Every thought perfect before the Lord. How many of us could say that we recognize that we still have that indwelling sin bent within us, even though we're saved people? Paul's just evaluating himself honestly here. He called it the body of this death. Let me describe the picture he's painting for us here. It's not a pretty one. One of the most horrible, most cruel forms of punishment in our apostles' day was the method employed by the Romans. It was worse than crucifixion, I'm told. One of the ways of putting people to death was to take a corpse, someone who'd already been executed, and to strap that corpse onto the body of a live person. Can you imagine it? You can imagine what it must have been like as that corpse began to rot. What an abhorrent presence that would have been. Well, Paul's painting that very picture when he illustrates the ever-present problem that his sinful nature presented to him. He said, "Who shall deliver me from the body of this death?" Paul couldn't escape his sinful nature. No matter how fervently he tried, he absolutely could not rid himself of it. The law didn't do it. Outward sin was not Paul's problem. But never doubt for a second that Paul did not struggle with the covetousness and concupiscence he's revealing to us here as he's being very honest. He's putting his innermost self on display to you, and he's saying, "Inside me dwelleth no good thing. In my flesh, that is, dwelleth no good thing." How many of us can honestly say that about ourselves? In our flesh dwelleth no good thing. If we weren't in Christ, would there be any good about us at all? Nothing. In our position in Christ, now we can bear fruit unto God, but it's only in our position in Christ, not through this fleshly tent in which we dwell. So Paul's putting himself on display. Now, you tell me, was Paul defeated? Watch me very closely here as we move from verse 24 to 25 in our text. Who shall deliver me from the body of this death? Verse 25. I thank God through my newfound ability as a believer to no longer have those lustful thoughts I once had as an unbeliever. Is that what it says? Not on your life, but that's how many religious people would read it. I thank God through my newfound ability as a spiritual Jew to keep the law of Moses to a higher degree than the Jews could have ever kept it. I've eradicated those lustful thoughts altogether. They're not part of my life anymore. Not on your life. Who shall deliver me from the body of this death? I thank God through a return to rule-keeping for righteousness. My sinfulness has practically disappeared, and I've become a much prettier package from God's perspective. In that through the application of law principle on a daily basis, I've been able to keep my flesh in check. Why, the Ten Commandments have given me the victory. Not on your life, not on Paul's life, and not on Christ's life. The Ten Commandments didn't give you anything when it comes to your righteous standing before the perfectly righteous God of glory. He didn't give the law for the purpose of eradicating or reducing sin, folks. That wasn't the purpose of the law in the first place. He gave the law to showcase what's inside man. That, which was the only thing the law was ever capable of doing when it came to Israel or those who had never been placed under that law to begin with. God gave the law that sin might abound, Paul said, not abate or cease or lessen, that sin might abound. What did our apostle actually say? Here it is in verse 25. Who shall deliver me from the body of this death? I thank God. Not through a rule that tells me I'm to think only the purest of thoughts. But I thank God how? Through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind, my mental assent with God, that the law is holy and the commandment holy and just and good, I myself in my fleshly sin nature serve who? The law of sin. Couldn't get away from it. Couldn't get away from what that sin nature was doing inside him every minute of his day. The law of sin, folks, is nothing more than the ever-present sin nature that resides in the earthly tabernacle of all God's earthly human creation, given Adam's rebellion. Will continue to remain a part of your earthly tent until you receive your new tent. These fleshly tents will never be worthy of heaven, in that they'll never be able to perform to the measure of righteousness that's true of God. Otherwise, we'd go to heaven in our old tent, would we not? The tent we're in now. In my flesh dwelleth no good thing. Was not only a truth for Paul, it's equally true for every single one of us. Notice now the two directions to which Paul points in verse 25. I thank God through Jesus Christ. We can rejoice and we can give all the glory and the praise to the God and Father of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for the fact that even though that sinful nature is strapped onto our fleshly backs like a rotting corpse embedded in the earthly tent such that the law can't even extract it, God doesn't see us in our flesh from his judicial perspective, but in the Spirit. We are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, positionally speaking. He doesn't relate to us on the basis of our performance in the flesh, but on the basis of our new identification in his Son. That's how he views you. If we could just view ourselves in the manner in which God views us, we could do away with law-keeping for righteousness, and we could begin to cease dealing with God according to the law husband. Because as long as you're dealing with God according to the law husband, you're producing illegitimate fruit to God, no matter how good and godly that fruit looks. There are a lot of folks out there, Christians, quote-unquote, dealing with God. They wanted to be saved by grace, but now they're dealing with God according to the law husband. And God will not accept that fruit, again, no matter how good and godly it looks to man. It's illegitimate fruit. It's the Holy Spirit produced fruit in our lives. It's the only fruit God can accept. We can either allow the flesh to defeat us, or we can rejoice in the victory God's already given us by re-identifying us with the person of his perfect and glorious Son. And he did re-identify us. That's sanctification. It's through that new creation identification that we have the wonderful words of Romans 8:1. Therefore, there is therefore now no condemnation from the standpoint of God's attitude. No condemnation whatsoever should not be in our minds in spite of that sinful nature to them which are where? In Christ Jesus. Do you see it? What a wonderful passage and testimony to the exceeding riches of God's grace here in his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. Now notice the remainder of the verse where it says, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. This portion has been questioned by more than a few Bible scholars. Now, let me show you Romans 8:1 from the majority text manuscripts. Can I do that? Here it is. There is therefore no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. That's the majority text manuscripts right there. End of sentence, done. Now, let me show you Romans 8:1 in the majority text, in the minority text that came from the Alexandrian manuscripts. I put that on the overhead as well. Do you see it? It's up there. No, it's not up there. There should be nothing there. There should be a blank page there. That's because the minority text is missing all of Romans 8, verse 1. It's not in minority text. It's not that it got the first part of verse 1 right, but simply omitted the second. The minority text omits the entire verse. In fact, the minority text omits approximately 200 verses from Scripture, but that's another issue. The fact is, both the majority and the minority manuscripts include chapter 8, verse 4. Oh, there's the one. That's it in the majority. And we're done with it, so we won't go to that. the majority text, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh but after the Spirit, that walk after, not after the flesh but after the Spirit's been added. But it is in 8:4, that the righteousness of the law might be filled in us who walk not after the flesh but after the Spirit. So the idea there's there, even though it's not up in verse 8:1. The idea is present in verse 8, or verse 4 of Romans 8. What does it mean to walk after the flesh and to walk after the Spirit? Walking after the flesh does not have to do with sinning. That's how it's brought out, and that's how it's defined by people who want to keep the issue of sin on the table of God's justice. Walking after the flesh is what you agree with in your mind. Are you in the flesh or in the Spirit? Walking after the flesh is what Israel was doing as they thought they had righteousness in themselves through their performance. Walking after the flesh is dealing with God as though you can earn your righteousness through what you do. Walking after the Spirit is not walking after the flesh. Walking after the Spirit is agreeing in your mind that your only life you have in God's presence is through your identification with His Son. That's walking after the Spirit. And so as long as you're dealing with God according to the law of husband, and people are dealing with God according to the law of husband, there is no righteousness in that. Because you might produce all the fruit that looks wonderful on the outside, but God knows the difference. It's illegitimate fruit. You're producing it to the law, not to Christ. The law had to be dead. You had to be dead to the law. And that's exactly what Paul explained to us in our previous sessions. So then that they are that in the flesh cannot please God. But you're not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. The question remains, is there a way for believers to be victorious in their daily lives? If the law won't help them gain the victory over the flesh, the answer is yes, there is. Live in the reality of who God's already made you to be in His Son. Live in that reality every day. This is the sanctification or set apartness Paul teaches here in the sanctification cornerstone of Romans. He wants us to do what we do and abstain from that from which we abstain, not from the standpoint of gaining God's favor or gaining more points with God, but from the standpoint of our sanctified position in His Son. We do what we do out of appreciation for what we've already got, not in order to get. That's applying law principle, and that's walking after the flesh.
Thank you for joining with us in your endeavor to discover the